all the time. Well, we play it here all the time anyway. How long ago did you write this, Al?
I wrote that, Gerald, in 1970, I guess, about five, six years ago. And I originally wrote it to be performed in the Doug Kahn group, which Henry Franklin was a part of, and he heard it. We performed it. We never recorded it with Doug, but he dug it, and he wanted to record it. And so he recorded it. Later on, Doug wrote some lyrics for it. I plan to record it again with the lyrics and maybe do it up a little differently, but I do plan to record it.
Did Doug, did he already, he's already written some lyrics for
it? Yes, we were doing it, when we were doing it in Doug's band, Jean was singing. We, along with the horn, she was singing. We would play, and then she would maybe sing the line, and Doug had written some beautiful lyrics.
He also did some lyrics for Naima and
he was,
some other things.
Right. He was really one of the first, you know, people that was basically a jazz recording artist to really begin utilizing the voice with the new wave of it. I mean, it's been happening for a while. Mm-hmm. When I first heard it, I think it was Max Roach, Abby Lincoln, the percussion Bittersweet album was when I really, you know, started digging. That's the way I like for the voice to be used in an ensemble. I mean, it can be used many, many other ways, and I mean, I don't have, and I'm not knocking that, obviously.
Yeah.
But I like to use the voice, you know, along, kind of like along with the ensemble.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, obviously all the heavyweight singers can take care of their own, you know. Yeah. We're not even into that, but I mean, you know, using the voice the way Doug used it. A lot of people are doing that now.
Uh-huh.
That's what I'm trying to say, and he was one of the first ones to, you know, take the
newer,
Love Supreme and, and some of the more recent jazz standards.
Right.
He put lyrics to the melodies.
Very good. Anyway, it's a really fine fine number there you've written, JoJo. And now tell me this, Al, you you know, we've been talking, and you've been over to Africa a couple of times, South Africa.
Right.
While you were over there, you got a chance to look around and hear some of the music of the continent.
Right.
And tell me about it. How'd you feel the first time you were in Africa? What did you hear? Can you remember?
Yes, I can remember. Well, I didn't know, Gerald, you know, like, you know, going to South Africa, you know. I mean, I had to really think about that, you know, but I decided to go because, you know, we've all always been saying, most of the guys I know always have been advocating that music was a universal language. Therefore, you know, to me it transcends politics.
Uh-huh.
So I went over to play some music and to hear some music and to meet some people and to do what I do. And while over there, see, I seek out, you know. I seek what I want, you know. And I heard some very heavy music over there. Sometimes I have some albums that I could bring by and let you hear. Some of the South African jazz groups. There's a variety of music being played there, just like here. You know, there's the music that's more earthy, you know, closer to the bush, and then it's, you know, more commercial type music being played there. The music industry there, to me, was not much different than it is here, or any place that I've been.
You know what, we're going to get a chance to hear some recordings. I know I see one here that I've already played on the show before, but I noticed an influence there of the African rhythms, and actually the sound that you guys were attempting to get, and which you did a wonderful job. Also, the soloists, the guys doing the improvising there, were getting right into the feel of the thing, seemed with no problem of.
Well, I think what happened, Gerald, was we got over there and we experienced a lot of things, and we fused what we experienced with what we already do. And consequently, a sound more or less developed, you know, and when I was dealing with the tonalities and the rhythms that I heard there, I tried to, you know, mix some of the things that, you know, I could bring into the music there, and hopefully, you know, something happened.
You know, I was talking with some of the other musicians that made that trip with you, and they were telling me some of the experiences, and of course they were explaining to me that some of the natives of South Africa did get a chance to hear you guys, that they'd have a special show, that they would be able to come in and see you.
Well, Gerald, the first time that we went over, we played in Johannesburg, for instance, in a place that I would classify kind of like the auditoriums downtown, you know, music centers and whatnot. Uh-huh. It was like that. And they had not mixed performances, they had separate performances on some occasions, and then on other occasions it would be more of a multi-racial type situation. Uh-huh. But definitely there's more to this thing than we can get into on the radio, yeah, and that meets the eye and that comes through the media, I have to say this. Mm-hmm. But we did go out to the township, to the people, and play the music. I mean, we played a concert in Orlando, Soweto, which is in South Africa, and there were 20,000 black people there, you know, that could not have afforded to come into the city to, you know, hear the music regardless, you know? And I think getting the music there was the, you know, most exciting thing, was getting the music out there. And I mean, there are people here in LA that can't afford to go and see some of the concerts at the downtown. So I mean, we have very similar situations, you know.
Well, this is not, and like you say, you got to get started sometimes, you know, those same things were happening right here. And
I can remember some, Jerry.
Right, you know, and all over the South, and many places in the North, you had to bring the music to our people until they finally got together where things are cool in many of the places.
Right.
And of course, things are not cool in a lot of places here still.
That's right, Jerry.
So you're taking the music to the people.
Right, the last time we went over, quite a few of the members in the band, and people were sending material that didn't even go, books and whatnot. You see, there's a situation there where they're behind, you know, not only everybody, well, obviously they're behind, look at the situation, you know.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, I think our going over there really helped to, I saw a lot of barriers break down between the first time and the second time that I went over.
In other words, the second trip, things you saw, doors opening that hadn't opened the other time.
Right, although I don't think the conditions for the band were as good the second time, but the conditions that, you know, that the people were dealing with there, the South African people, had seemed to have mellowed out a little bit. There were some things happening that are unbelievable there.
Well, good. At least it was all done for the best, and you were trying to...
I think so.
Right. Al Hall, our guest today, ladies and gentlemen, we were just talking about a few things about his trip to South Africa. We'll be back after some action with Jim Gosa. We're going to get into some more music. Right, Jim?
Well, the word is that Bill Hancock and Sahib Shahab have some good news from Mr. Bojangles. That's the Styles for Men store at 3710 West Santa Barbara in the Fashion Village Shopping Center. Mr. Bojangles is now open for business and offering big savings on high-style menswear, leisure suits, the popular French slacks, tapered body shirts and the new patterns, dress shirts, neckwear, and leather coats and jackets, too. Mr. Bojangles, Styles for Men in the Fashion Village Shopping Center. You can use your Bank AmeriCard, your Master Charge, Mr. Bojangles' own revolving charge account, or layaway, too. And Bill and Sahib are ready there to assist you with all your clothing needs. So stop by and say hello to our old friends, Bill Hancock and Sahib Shahab, at Mr. Bojangles, Styles for Men, 3710 West Santa Barbara in the Fashion Village Shopping Center. Thank you, Jim.
Okay, Jim, now back with Al. Al, what do we got coming up now, music-wise?
Well, this is something that I enjoy doing. This is from the Pat Britt album, Jazz Man.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a composition and arrangement by Kent Glenn, pianist, arranger, composer. This is called Wild Lily, and I got a chance to play a little bit on this. And Kent writes some nice ensemble things that I think are interesting in the form of an outchorus like. And the guys on this, Pat Britt, he's the leader, he's playing, I think he's playing soprano sax solo on this one. Kent Glenn is on piano, this is his arrangement and composition.
Mm-hmm.
Francois Vaz is playing guitar. Pat Smith is on bass, and Harold Jones.
Yeah, on drums.
Taking care of some drum work, definitely. So I think that was it on the personnel. I'm sorry, Gary Barone Did I say Gary? Yes, Gary Barone is playing trumpet and flugelhorn on this. Right. Leave Gary.
Yeah. Right. You know, Gary's an alumni of my band, too. Mm-hmm. He's in the band about a year. And, of course, his brother was with us for a couple of years. He's like my right-hand man for a couple of years. Mike Barone.
Right.
So the Barone brothers are really tough. Sounds like some tough gangsters.
Is Mike a trombone?
Mike plays trombone, yeah.
Right,
does fine writing in some of my albums.
Mm-hmm.
And, okay, here it is, though, the music from the album Pat Britt there, and we played this album on our show before. Jazz Man is the title of the album. We're going to hear the number titled Wild Lily.
Okay.
Thank you. The Blackbirds have been together 3 years. Now Donald Byrd's protégés are ready to face the city life.
Flying high into the sky, you and me. Flying high.
The Blackbirds are flying high and cooking. City Life, the Blackbirds' new fantasy album, shows off all the flair, style, and grace that you can get only from the woodsheds of Rock Creek Park. City Life also features the new Blackbird single, Happy Music. City Life, available now from Fantasy Records.
Get City Life, the new album by the Blackbirds, and be sure to see the Blackbirds in person this weekend, Saturday and Sunday night, at the Coconut Grove in the Ambassador Hotel on Wilshire Boulevard. This is KBCA in Los Angeles, jazz 24 hours a day in stereo, and we'll return you to Gerald Wilson and Al Hall Jr. on Jazz Capsule in just a half a moment. Jazz City Record Store and Blue Note Records are having a big bonanza sale going on right now. The entire Blue Note catalog is on special sale at Jazz City with artists like Donald Byrd and Bobby Humphrey and Chick Corea and Jimmy Witherspoon and Ronnie Laws. The whole Blue Note catalog on sale at Jazz City Records at 714 West Florence Avenue. You can get a great saving on the dynamite new Donald Byrd album, Places and Spaces, Fancy Dancer by Bobby Humphrey, and a marvelous new Jimmy Witherspoon album. You heard that, Gerald? That new Spoon album? Oh, it's a dynamite.
I know it's dynamite.
Yeah,
everything
sure.
He does is dynamite.
Super fine. Anyway, all those things are on sale, as well as those double album reissues featuring Chick Corea and Paul Chambers and John Coltrane and Lester Young. Some great stuff.
Yeah.
They're all on sale now at Jazz City at 714 West Florence Avenue, Florence and Hoover. Gerald, thank you.
You know, that's really a new group of records that they've just released, really something
else.
Yeah,
some great stuff. You were playing it the other day, love it, Charlie.
Yeah, great artists there on Blue Note Records. Anyway, we'll get back to our guest, though, because we got just a little while left now, Al, and we want to get as much music as possible and as much talk as possible. One thing, just want to get into things. Now, you're here in Los Angeles. This is home now, right?
Right.
Uh-huh. And you're based, right now you're busy doing some work on your endowment, number for the endowment. And I think that's very good, and that'll keep you kind of busy there.
Definitely.
And so you can be doing a little work around with your horn and
right.
your pen,
right?
Thrown in there.
Yeah, I hope to maybe start rehearsing my own group. I
mm-hmm.
have some material that I'd like to get played. There are some things that I anticipate, Gerald. You know, I can't really get into them. I probably would be jumping the gun, but I just want to continue what I'm doing, man, and. Move ahead and keep playing music and, write.
Very good, very good. And Al, we sure hope you will continue to write and continue to do all kinds of writing. As you know, right now is a time that more than ever, I believe we need some young writers because there's not too much happening in the writing business right now. The older fellas are tired, they all have ghosts and those, and they're just tired and you need new spark,
Yeah, well, I just, hope that I can, fit in the chain, I mean, like there have been so many great writers down through the years, including yourself, and, I just try to learn from everybody and continue what, the momentum that's already set,
It's already be,
right, I just want to be your own,
ago.
Yes,
right.
I just want to be a part of that.
Right, and it's really come from a long ways, too, because, I deal in the history of jazz, too.
Right.
They say the first great jazz writer was really Jelly Roll Morton, because Jelly Roll was already playing in the club in 1902 when he was 17. Of course, we know the Duke was only 3 then.
Right.
And so...
he was playing.
We know he was playing,
yeah.
But, and then old Jelly Roll, and after Jelly Roll, Fletcher Henderson,
right.
and Duke Ellington, Don Redman and Cy Oliver, just right on down through today, So we got to have these younger guys to come on in and pick up the chain and let's keep going. Right now, we're going to keep going with the music, huh?
Okay.
And this time we're going back to the new album here, and this is really some cover here, Henry Franklin at Home.
Yeah,
and he's got
Skip at Home, that's his latest.
He's about, I counted the people one day, there's over 100 people here.
Yeah, a lot of people.
And you recognize a lot of them, I see Oscar Brashear standing over here, and a lot of the guys, you around here, and in fact, so many people. But anyway, this is called Skipper at Home.
Right.
One number that was really good for you on this, and it's a number called Blue Lights.
Right.
Tell us about it, and then we'll get into
Blue Lights, I imagine, because, it has that, rock R&B samba kind of combination happening, and we're doing it with an acoustic bass, and that added another dimension to it, you know. And I think we have like a Fender piano and acoustic bass, and that's not really what you would expect, you know. Probably would be expecting a Fender or electric bass, and so it's just like a contemporary kind of thing.
I'm sure glad that you have the upright on here, because it's still a beautiful instrument.
Right. It's, okay. Right.
All right. Here it is. Blue Lights.
profiles highlight contributions blacks have made.
Okay, Jim, sounded like some of the bicentennial stuff coming on there.
Yeah, something's wrong with that card. I'll fix it here in a minute. We'll get it on.
We've just heard Blue Lights, which is an exciting number written by in-person guest Al Hall Jr., this time featuring the fine trumpet work again of Oscar Brashear, Charles Owens on tenor sax, Al Hall, of course, our guest, Jr., on trombone, Sanduza on, that's Bill Henderson, on soprano sax.
Right.
You know, yeah. He also plays the drums, too.
Piano, he's beautiful.
Right. Kirk lights here at the piano and doing some flute where he...
Right.
He's really an outstanding musician,
yes,
too.
Yes,
you know,
play the bassoon now.
Right.
You know.
Had the pleasure of meeting him, Al, when he was conducting and accompanying Demeter Joe.
Right.
My band was playing in New York, and we really had a fine engagement there.
Incidentally, Gerald, not meaning to cut you off, but Kirk Licey had the band that accompanied Lovelace on the recent tour this year.
I know that he, of course, did a fine job because
yes,
he knows where he's going,
definitely.
He knows where he's at, and
right,
does it all. David Dura, again, doing some piano work. Ndugu, Leon Chancellor on drums, and Kenny Climax on guitar. In the album, The Sisters' Happiness, do some vocal work. Right now, though, ladies and gentlemen, talking with Al Hall, we have just, Al, just about time now to get in our last cut.
Okay,
and Jerry. You've played everyone's album, and what are we going to hear now?
Yeah, well, this is from an album that I had the pleasure of recording in South Africa. Probably the first time that this has been done. I co-produced this album and also worked with Charles Mallory.
Uh-huh.
This is called Song of Soweto, which is short for Southwestern Townships.
Uh-huh.
And Charles Mallory arranged for us to get this date, and we call this the Mallory Hall Band, and this is... my first effort as a producer. I co-produced this with Charles.
Mm-hmm.
And I've selected from this one of my compositions and arrangements. This is called Hamba Samba, which means Go Samba. And we have some straight ahead jazz sections in it. And we also have a little R&B kind of section that bridges everything on the outside and the at the end.
Okay.
Right.
And once again, the title?
Hamba Samba.
Okay. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen, our in-person guest from the album Song of Soweto, the Mallory Hall Band. Thank you. And that's the Hamba Samba composition by in-person guest Al Hall Jr. This was from the Mallory Hall Band. That's Charles Mallory and, of course, our guest. The other members of the orchestra here recorded in South Africa, Marshall Royal, Herman Riley, and Rudolph Johnson in the reed section, Danny Cortez, Tommy Cortez, Julius Billy Brooks in the trumpet section. Right. There's some fine trumpeters there. And, of course, my man George Buster Cooper and you in the trombone section.
Right.
And Kurt Leitze, along with Curtis Kirk on drums, Johnny Bashoff on bass and congas, and of course Charles doing the guitar work, and Delbert Hill on reeds.
Right.
And really, this time the band sounding really good, and some fine work again, Al.
Thank you,
Gerald.
I know
you must be pretty proud of the album.
Yes, I am. Uh-huh. I'm proud of it, and I hope to, just build from that. It's a starting point.
Right, sure sounded nice. We played it here on the show before, and Hamba Samba. What's Hamba?
Hamba, that means go.
Go, yeah, go right. Samba.
Go Samba.
Is that African for go?
Right.
Go ahead. Right. I know one African.
One of the dialects.
Hamba.
Right.
Well, we're getting ready to do the Hamba.
Right.
Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, today on Jazz Capsule, our guest has been Al Hall Jr., trombonist, composer, arranger, and all-around fine person. Al Hall, on behalf of KBC, the old jazz station, Jim Gosa with me today, myself, and I want to thank you so much for taking time out to come and share your career with us.
Thank you, Gerald, and thank you, Jim.
My pleasure. Thank you. I enjoyed it a lot.
We'll be looking forward to more good work from you and looking forward to have you again. Right now, we just want to remind our audience that come Monday, we'll be talking with Abby Lincoln on Jazz Capsule. Also, next week, we'll talk with Anita O'Day and Kai Winding, in-person guests next week on Jazz Capsule. Ladies and gentlemen, Gerald Wilson here once again with Jim Gosa and Al Hall Jr. Thanks so much for listening. Have a good weekend. I'll see you Monday, Jim.
All right, have a good weekend, Joe.
Thank you.
This is KBCA, Los Angeles, the Jazz Station.
Yes, we got the...